I had to have a prop. Consider the lichen, the lowly lichen. You've seen them on tree bark and stones. What are they exactly? They don't move, they don't grow much, but you learned about them in high school. What did you learn? Do you remember? Lichens are an amazing example of a symbiotic relationship between two organisms. They're neither plant nor animal. Under the microscope, you'll see two organisms that work together in a symbiotic relationship. The fungus provides structure, provides a matrix, holds water, and the little green unicellular algae within gather the light from the sun through photosynthesis and make the sugar to grow the fungus. So it's a symbiotic relationship. It's relatively, I don't want to say it's boring, but it's, you know, it's quiet. And it's an example, I'm presenting it to you as an example or metaphor for our own human relationship with the plants that we need to survive. So, for example, we're fully dependent upon corn. Every item in your grocery store has some sort of corn product in it: corn starch, corn meal, corn syrup, corn oil. One scientist said that 69% of the carbon in our own bodies can be traced directly to the corn products that we ate. We're dependent upon corn, and yet you don't think of this, but corn is totally dependent upon us. If you throw a corn cob in a field, it cannot grow to complete its life cycle. The seeds are crowded, it needs fertilizer, it needs fungicide. So we're a symbiotic relationship with the plants that we grow to keep us alive. Corn is just one of three important crops that we have. Wheat, rice are the other two, but they make up 42% of our calorie requirements worldwide. That's astounding. What's even more astounding is that the other 58% is made up of only 30 plants, roughly 30 plants. So we don't really have a very diverse diet. There's a lot of plants out there, and we're solely dependent on all of these. You probably all remember reading about the Irish potato famine. Maybe some of your relatives came here to this country at that time when the potato crop in Ireland caused the death of 1 million people and the emigration of another 1 million people, thus cutting the population by 25%. What you didn't hear about is the Great American Corn Famine that didn't happen in 1971. A fungus disease came through the country, decimated our corn. Luckily, in the year 1971, scientists, plant scientists, got their act together, figured out what the problem was, solved it, and the next year we had a full complement of the corn that we needed to survive. Well, thank goodness for that. But there could be another disease right around the corner. We have global warming to contend with. There are all sorts of eventualities. Who are the scientists who are on the front lines now? Where are they coming from? Well, guess what? Most of them have gone into biomedical because really that's where the resources are. Basic plant science and applied plant science turn out fewer than 1,000 PhDs every year, a third of what is turned out in biomedical sciences. And this is unconscionable. 50% of the scientists who presently work for the US government as plant biologists will be retiring in 15 years. We don't have a plan to replace them. So another, maybe the Great American Corn Famine is right around the corner, we don't know. So I'd like to address how this came to be. And it really goes back to our childhood and to history. When my grandmothers were children, it was commonplace, in fact, all high school students studied botany. On a fairly technical level, in fact, they went to the forest, they collected plants, they learned the names of 30 different plants, they made herbarium specimens in a scrapbook, and at the end of the year, if they lived in New York State, they took a Regents exam in botany. If you grew up in New York State, you know it no longer exists. It was discontinued in about 1940. Well, what is botany? Botany is just simply a type of plant science, any type of plant science. Here's a botanist working in the herbarium at the New York Botanical Gardens, comparing dried, pressed specimens of plants that may no longer exist on Earth, maybe have their habitat had been destroyed many years ago. We don't know. Botanists may do genetic engineering. They may do DNA sequencing. They do all sorts of work. But we are not educating them, and this is really the problem. High school no longer contains any botany other than just maybe a little bit about photosynthesis. But most students graduate from high school not even being aware that plants, like animals, respire. They breathe as well. So there's why can't we have high school biology botany education? It's because the teachers themselves are not educated. There's no botany being taught in colleges. College universities now are reducing the number of botany classes that they offer. Our university here offers one every other year. Other universities across the country have cut the number of botany programs are being combined with biology programs. So we're simply not training our next generation of botanists. Well, I belong to the Botanical Society of America. It's a professional organization of about 3,000 botanists, and our membership peaked in 1975. We are aware of the problem. We launched a Twitter campaign, hashtag I am a botanist. You can go on Twitter right now and check it out. And a while back, one of us wrote an article describing plant blindness. And we talked to each other about plant blindness in the general public. Now, I'm guessing that you don't know what plant blindness is, but you're starting to guess. Plant blindness is the inability to see or notice the plants in one's own environment, and the tendency to rank plants as inferior to animals. Okay, so I know, I'm not disillusioned here. I know that you would much rather be listening to a guy talking with a big snake than a little old lady botanist talking about, you know, standing in front of a chia pet and talking about lichens. I'm realistic. There is no charisma in botany. This is a natural thing. You are all watching kitten videos, baby elephant videos. You love lemurs. Plants, not so much. But don't forget, the baby elephants and the lemurs and the pandas, they don't have plant blindness. They all know that they're dependent upon their food. And we need to remember that ourselves and look beyond. So I promised you a cure for plant blindness. And most of you, maybe some of you, are in the position to change careers and take advantage of really what is a gap. If you decide you want to go into plant biology, your opportunities for employment are much greater than if you're, I believe, in biomedical science. The competition at least is less. So I'm hoping that some of you will want to consider that for a career. Or maybe there are some policymakers or teachers here who would consider using their influence to increase the role of botany in our curricula. But then, you know, we all recycle, we all turn off the lights and conserve energy, and we do that not because we as individuals think we're going to save the world, we're just doing our part. So I'm asking you now to do your part in whatever little way works for you to help cure plant blindness on a global scale. And so I'm just going to give you some cute little ideas here. Doesn't take too much time or effort. You can look at your salad. Most people don't know that when you put that lettuce leaf in your mouth and bite down on it, it's a living thing. Those cells aren't dead yet. You're eating something alive. What part of the plant are you eating? You can eat flowers, of course. So look at your food, read some of Michael Pollan's books. He talks about the botany of desire. Just educate yourself. So see how easy this is? You can do this every day. And you can do it with children, too. This is the best part. You can grow your own if you have the means, and if not, just get yourself an amaryllis bulb. Go out right now and get it put in, you know, grow it. And, of course, the chia pet. I love chia pets for this reason. Do you know most children in middle school in the urban environment will tell you they have never planted a seed? That's crazy. Why not a chia pet then? So once you're growing something, look at it. Plants do respond to their environment, but not in our time frame. You have to slow down or get a time-lapse camera and photograph it. They don't have brains. They don't have neurons. They don't have eyes. They don't have ears. How do they sense their environment? Well, plant biologists have been trying to find out. Maybe one of you will solve the problem because we don't really know. Go out in the woods, visit the Ashley Schiff Park Preserve. While you're there, take some pictures. Or this is one of my favorite tricks, bring home a little piece of a plant and put it on your flatbed scanner. Scan it at high resolution, blow it up really big. You can see lots of details. You can make a beautiful picture. You can make a card, poster, hang it on the wall, whatever. Just enjoy the plants around you. Oh, there. Okay. If you need to know the names of the plants, there's an app for that, and it's a free app. It's called Leaf Snap. You put it on your smartphone and take a picture of a leaf, and through shape recognition technology, you'll be given the name of the plant, or at least close to it. So all of these things, if I can say this again, you should do with children, young people, because this is how the next generation. I see you going for your cell phones now. This is good. Look at that. I got a rise out of them. So do it with children. Go out in the forest and use your LeafSnap app. And don't do like this guy and anthropomorphize your plants and put googly eyes on them to make them soft and cuddly, because they never will be. They're plants. They have, you know, their own lives, and they really are very interesting. I'm sorry I didn't tell you about all the wonderful things that you can learn about plants. You can do that on your own. But I'd like to come back to the analogy that I started with, that lichen thing. So we're the fungus in this relationship. We're the ones dependent upon the plants. We need to remember that. We need to honor that. We need to remember that the plants need our protection, need our understanding, need our awareness. And so we need to do as we did in the 60s and ask, have you thanked a green plant today? Thank you. Thanks.